Are you tired? Who could just crawl under the porch and take a nap right now? So you see my challenge, right? Okay. Open your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, obviously, today being Easter. We're not going to get into this, but I am pretty much convinced Jesus was crucified on Wednesday, not Friday. There's not enough time, according to the Jewish timekeeping system, from Friday to Sunday, but there is from Wednesday. Doesn't matter. We know that he rose from the grave. Anyway, glad you're here. I appreciate your presence. And we're going to begin reading in verse number 35. Paul's great at anticipating questions. Now, I know you're going to ask this, so let me go ahead and answer it. And he did that all through the books that he wrote. And he's done that here in chapter 15, beginning of verse number 35. So if everybody's there, say amen. If you're not, say, oh me. Say, wait a minute. All right, we'll wait a minute. Again, I want to thank the ladies for fixing a phenomenal breakfast. That was really, really good. So thank you all very much for that. All right, we ready? Look at verse 35. But some man will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Two questions that are pretty pertinent to this matter of resurrection. How in the world is something dead going to live again? And number two, what's it going to look like? Thou fool. So Paul just gently gets into the answer here. That which thou sowest is not quickened or raised up except it die. And that which thou sowest, thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain. You plant a watermelon seed, when it comes out of the ground, it doesn't look like a watermelon, does it? It looks like something completely different, but it's going to develop into that. It may chance of wheat or some other grain, but God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body or his own appearance. All flesh is not the same flesh. There's one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies. Now that means those bodies that exist in the heavens, stars and planets and things. There are also terrestrial bodies, which is the earth. But the glory of the celestial is one. The glory of the terrestrial is another. Let's stop right there. This book was written to a group of people in Corinth, Greece. They had been saved out of Greek culture, one of the most influential cultures that has ever existed. And they did believe in an afterlife, not a Christian type of belief, but they did believe in an afterlife. And these beliefs were based on a rather varied sources of cultural myths and legends and things like that that was passed down from one generation to another. And they were adjusted to individual preferences, naturally. If you don't like this, we'll just add this, we'll take this away. And so it was a little bit on the unique side. And the Greeks believed that the souls of the deceased were not reincarnated. They did not believe in reincarnation. They did believe that you were placed into bodily form back into either heaven, their version of heaven, or their version of hell. All right? It's completely different than what the Scripture teaches about heaven and hell. But their afterlife destination was based not on your belief in anything, but how well you behaved. And this is called auto-soterism. Auto-soterism just simply means self-salvation. You save yourself by being really, really good. You know, you bake your pie, your neighbor a pie. You take them to the doctor. You mow their yard. You're just really sweet to kids. And the Lord will look at that and say, oh, wow, you deserve to come to heaven. That's the idea of Greek mythology. And the resurrection of the body was not part of Greek belief. They did not believe in this at all. And so when Paul comes along and he writes this book, and of course he's preaching these things as well, it was at cross purposes with Greek culture. They did not believe what Paul was preaching, although they had been participating in the principle of resurrection for centuries, because they were an agrarian society. They were farmers. They had planted stuff for centuries, wheat and barley and all that stuff. And they knew how to do it. They knew if you took the seed and you planted it in the ground, covered it up, waited a little while. Of course, they didn't understand all of the ins and outs of how that happened. But after a while, boom, a little sprout would come out of the ground. It didn't look anything like what you planted. You planted a seed, you get this little sprout with leaves on it, so it looked completely different. But was it germinally connected? Yeah. Yes, it was germinally connected. And so when the plant would grow up, produce a fruit, wheat for instance, then the wheat would look like what you did plant in the ground. And so here's what I've discovered through the years. If a false belief about anything arises in a culture, it's going to find its way into a church. It's going to become Christianized. It's going to be painted with the colors of biblical terminology, even though it's as false as it can be. The purpose is to make it look like a Christian painting. And so Paul is going to ask two questions, I think, that are valid even today. He asks these people, I know some of you are thinking, number one, how? How can something dead, if you kill a deer and he's graveyard dead, what can you do to raise him from the dead? Can you cut the bullet out? Pull the arrow out? Once he's dead, he's dead, right? So how's he going to come back to life? Well, the question that these people were asking was, if a human being dies, we have never seen a human being die and then come back to life. They've never seen that. So there's question number one, how? Number two, what's it going to look like? Now, you know what Hollywood says people that come back from the dead look like. They always have stiff joints, you know, and their clothes are always real sketchy, and they walk like that, and I don't know where they got that idea, but we have this zombie version of the resurrected person, not biblical at all, but at least that's what man thinks is going to happen. Well, let's look at this honestly. How? How many of you in here have had a family member die? Okay, we all have. Where is their body? Still in there, in the casket, right? And the casket's in the vault, and the vault's in the ground. They hadn't gone anywhere. But the Bible says that one day they will be raised from the grave. Either they were lost or they're saved. There is no third option. They were either redeemed or they were unredeemed. And when that happens, we've got two completely different destinies that we're not going to talk about right now. But I think that's a very valid question. How can something dead be brought to life? Well, number one, again, these guys are farmers, and here's what they'd been doing for centuries, planting stuff. Here's what happens. You take your seed, which is nothing more than a tiny just add water kit for new life. That's all you got to do. They have found English peas, green peas, in pyramids that were 5,000 years old, dry as baby powder, shriveled up. You know what they did? They planted them. You know what happened? They grew, all right? They were just waiting for the right combination of light and moisture. And so kept safe within the seed coat of a plant, or the seed is the embryo. And this embryo lies dormant until some very certain conditions are met. Got to have the right amount of moisture. Got to have the right amount of light, and when those conditions are met, this little embryo will spring to life and the thing will grow. Now, specific, very, very specific requirements must be met. And here's what happens. If you water the seed, there's a hole in that seed, and this seed just simply needs to be germinated. And the coating of that seed will absorb that water, and it will cause the germ to wake up. And as the germ grows, it splits that outer shell. Then the plant breaks ground, and you've got whatever you have planted. And there are some plants that don't even need light or water. They don't need to be planted in the ground. Moss, for instance, is an air plant. Y'all have air plants that grow in your trees, and you don't need to plant them, and so they just need those right conditions. And as the seed swells, it's rehydrated with the water, and there's a process called imbibition. And imbibition is just simply this rehydrated germ that swells. And it wakes up, and it's like, okay, boys, it's time to go. And as it pushes out, it tears up the seed. And this is what the Greeks had been doing for centuries. They've been planting seeds. They would water those seeds. The water would get inside the hole in the shell of that seed, wake up the seed germ. The seed germ would begin to spread through the process of imbibition. It would split the coat and break the ground and become a new plant. And they had been working with this process of resurrection for centuries and didn't know it. They didn't recognize it. And so how is this going to happen? And Paul said, you fool, and the English equivalent of that word is you idiot. So, you idiots, you've been doing this for centuries. You plant the seed, and what comes out of the ground? Why are you asking me why is this going to happen? You, more than anybody, know how this works. And so what's going to happen? Well, one day, see, our bodies are seeds. Inside the seed is the germ, and the scripture refers to that as the person of the Holy Spirit. We have within us the seed of God, the Bible says. You have the person of the Holy Spirit. Now, why aren't we perfect physically now? Because the seed hadn't been planted yet. But one day, we're all going to experience death. The bodies are going to be planted in the ground, and then at the resurrection, the seed is going to spring up into life, and you're going to be a glorified individual, have a glorified body. The old physical body will be split, is going to be discarded, stay in the ground. And so when the leaves leave the ground, they start growing out of the ground. Here's what they do. Through what's called photosynthesis, the light shines down on the leaf. The light, through photosynthesis, is turned into sugar. Sugar then feeds the plant. So built into the very DNA of whatever you plant is the process of resurrection. So how does it happen? You die. You are buried. At some point, then the Lord will then raise us from the grave, and we will have a new glorified body. So that's how it's going to happen. Question number two, what are you going to look like? You ever seen any movie about, you know, people in heaven? You know, they've got rings of light around their head, and they got wings and all this kind of stuff. Look real carefully. Do you see a ring of light around my head? Well, actually, you might. You might, actually. I have no wings, and so that's not going to be part of the process. Now, Paul is going to explain this matter of what are we going to look like? Well, let me ask you this question. What do you look like now? You know, you're going to look like you do now, only perfect. What does a perfect you look like? Now we've stepped off into some pretty deep water. I have no clue, because I've never seen a perfect person. Every person I've ever seen is like me, you know? They've got physical problems, they've got aches and pains and all this kind of stuff. Now, but let's take a look. Paul is going to, he's going to get a little more detailed about this matter of physical bodies than he did with the question about how it's going to happen. Look at verse number 37. That which thou sowest not that body that shall be. You plant a wheat, kernel of wheat. A kernel of wheat's not going to pop out of the ground. A wheat stalk that doesn't even look like wheat is going to come out of the ground, but bear grain. It may have chance be wheat or some other grain, whatever you plant. But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, as it will. We got oak trees on the property. These oak trees look like the first oak tree. That's what God wanted an oak tree to look like. We've got palmettos all over Florida. That's exactly what God wanted a palmetto to look like. We got all kinds of different kind of plants. We got roses and hibiscus. We got all that stuff. You can tell a rose from a hibiscus. They have different, they have body forms. That's the way God designed those forms to look. Verse number 19, all flesh is not the same flesh. And these are going to give four categories of physical bodies, or what's called biologically an animal body. We have an animal body, just a physical body that that exists on air and food and water and things like that. There's one kind of flesh of men. Oh, we're talking about not males, but mankind. Everybody in here looks alike. Now, there are some differences. I'm aware of, here's some differences, male and female. That's a difference. That's always going to be a difference, by the way. We've got some folks that are tall, some people are short. Some are dark-skinned, some are light-skinned. Some are bald, some have a lot of hair. And so we've got some differences, but we've got two eyes right here, a nose here, y'all didn't have to laugh about that. We've got a body that pretty much is similar. We look like Japanese people. Now, our eyes don't do that, I'm aware of that, but we still have two eyes here and a nose. All right, now, so we've got the flesh of men. Another flesh of beasts, and he's talking about animals, quadrupeds. We got all kinds of quadrupeds. We've got possums. We've got cows. We've got horses and dogs and cats and coyotes and wolves and musk ox and wolverines. And we've got all kinds of different body styles. Another of fishes, all kinds of different fishes. You got snook, reds, speck. Catfish, you got all kinds, but they have the same basic body style. Another of birds. Birds look different. Eagle look different than a hummingbird. But they have some similarities. You got wings, you got a beak, and so there's some similarities there. Now he's going to step outside the physical realm of earth, and he says there are also celestial bodies. There are bodies in the heavens. There's the moon and the sun, and Venus, and Mercury, and the stars, and all of that. And there are also bodies terrestrial, that the glory of the terrestrial is one, the glory of the celestial is one, the glory of the terrestrial is another. Now, there's one glory of the sun. Now, the word glory here, it means magnitude or brilliance. You don't look at the sun. You can look at a star. There's a difference. You can look at the moon. Boy, the moon was beautiful the other night. Orange, just real, it looked full. And you can look at that, but don't look at the sun. And so there's a difference in the brilliance or the magnitude. Now, who did that? God designed the thermostat of the light that comes off of these bodies. And so he says, verse number 41, there is one glory of the sun, or one magnitude of the sun, another magnitude of the moon, another of the stars, for one star differeth from another in glory or in brilliance or magnitude. So not all stars are even on the same plane. And you're aware that all of the constellations that we have in our solar system, there are 12 major signs. They don't have anything to do with your birth traits or anything like that. Don't read your horoscope. That's a bunch of witchcraft. But there are 12 major signs in the heavens that we call it the zodiac here, and I don't like that word. I like the word that Job uses. He calls it the Maseroth. And so there are 12 signs in the heavens that have three. Each of these 12 signs have three smaller signs that are their assistants. And they tell the story of Jesus from the birth of Christ to the second coming is pictured in each of these 12 stars. And every month it changes. The Lord moves it to the next picture, to the next one, to the next one. And you, again, don't look at it and say, well, I'm a Gemini, that means I'm this kind of person. It's got nothing to do with your personality, nothing. It just simply reveals the story of Christ from the virgin birth to the second coming. And so, and they have different magnitudes, different brilliant capacities. And verse number 42 says, so also. That's the important two words, just like that. He's given us physical illustrations. Well, resurrection is impossible. No, it's not. It happens all the time on a physical level. You ladies and probably guys, how many of you have a garden? You have cooperated with the process of resurrection as long as you've had a garden. And so don't say, no, this is impossible. No, that's how we eat. This is how the plants and things are reproduced. So also is a resurrection. It is sown in corruption. Now what he's going to do, he is going to list some of the traits and the characteristics of the physical body. Now, these are some things that we are stuck with right now. And the four terms that he uses, beginning in verse number 41, going through verse 44, number one, corruption. These bodies are corrupt. And what does that mean? That means liable to decomposition. You say, well, I'm not decomposing. Look at your high school graduation picture and tell me that again. You know, you can look at your class that graduated in 1970 or whatever it was. You don't even recognize those people today. You know, if you go to your 40 or 50 year reunion, have you noticed the folks there be so old and bald, they don't even recognize you. Several years ago, I had the honor of escorting the homecoming queen at Winter Haven back in 1970. And I need to be careful right now. And it was just a wonderful experience is what that was. But we're corrupt. We're going to decompose. All right, number two, we have a body of dishonor, which means humiliation, physical humiliation. We have a body of weakness. We can't jump over a building in a single bound. We're getting slower all the time. You're hurting where you used to not hurt. You don't bounce out of bed anymore. Well, maybe these little guys here on the front might. But we're starting to wind down. The second law of thermodynamics is taking over, which says that the amount of energy and available energy in a closed system is depleting, which means we're not getting better. Evolution says we're getting better. No, we're not. We're getting worse. The earth is starting to wobble on its axis. It's slowing down. Why? Because we're coming to the end of time as we know it. People die all the time. In Hardy County and in the world, I think I forgot, I looked up one time the daily total of people that died, like 30,000 people a day, something like that, die. And so we're weak. Then we have a natural body. A natural body just simply means a physical body. Physicality ceases to exist at some point. We're all going to die. Everybody in here is going to die. How close are we to death? I have no clue. All things being equal, older people are closer to death than younger people, but there's no guarantee of that. Young people die all the time. But we're all going to experience that. Now, this is the seed. This seed is corrupt. It's dishonorable, it's weak, and it's natural. It is limited. It's going to be planted in the ground one day. One day you will breathe, we will breathe our last breath. We will expire. Expire means to breathe out. We've got exit signs over these doors. There's the book of Exodus, which means the road out. Exit means the way out. So what happens when you expire, you will breathe one last time. You've got one breath left. And the last breath we take will be an exhalation. There will not be an inhalation. We're going to experience that one day. Now, we are told that the new body that we're going to receive, this is what, once the body is planted, once the seed of our body is planted, here's what's going to come out of that. Incorruption, which means not liable to decomposition. If you die of a disease, I don't know what it is, doesn't matter what it is, your glorified body will not have that disease. You will not experience sickness. You will not experience loss, diminishment, or decomposition in any way, period. The new body will be completely different. Also, it will have a glory or a brilliance all of its own. It will be different than it is now. We have no... I don't shine, and neither do you. And against what I'm saying, I don't understand all there is to know about what's going to happen to us. I just know that when we die, the body's going to be planted at the resurrection. That old body's going to remain in the ground, and the seed of God is going to raise that person, and we will have a completely different appearance, yet the appearance will be the same. Now, There are two heads of the human race. There's a physical head and a spiritual head. Who is the physical head of the human race? Adam. We're all kin to Adam. Everybody in here, kin to Adam. There's another head of another race. And that other head of the other race is Christ. Adam was the head. He was the physical head of the human race. Jesus is the head of a spiritual race. So you have either you're in Adam or you're in Christ. So when God looks at the human race, he sees two men. He sees Adam and he sees Christ. You're in one or the other. There is no third person. You can't opt out. Well, I don't believe in that stuff. It doesn't matter what you believe. I'm not being rude. I'm just telling you, it doesn't matter if you believe this or not. This is the way God has designed this to work. Now, I know that there are people that are in Adam that try to act like they're in Christ. And there are people who are in Christ that act like they're still in Adam. I'm aware of all that. But you're in one or the other. Now, the physical, these bodies that we're in right now, we could not live in heaven in these bodies. Because these bodies are still touched with the principle of sin. Now, if you're saved, you don't have a sin account anymore. That has been taken care of with your faith in Jesus Christ. But we still have physical bodies. We still have a physical soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions. And these things are subject to thinking the wrong thing, feeling the wrong thing. One day that's going to be done away with. One day, yes. One day that's going to be eliminated forever. And the believer has got to experience this change in order to live in heaven. We could not live in heaven right now any more than a fish could live in an oak tree. It is out of its element. It would be impossible for that to happen. And the same thing is true with us. We've got to experience this change. In order to exist in heaven, we cannot be a physical creature. Now, animals do not experience this change. I know we love our dogs and we love our cats, and you know, I see people call them, you know, that's their fur babies and all this. And I'm aware of the connection that people have with their animals, but animals do not have spirit. Technically, an animal does have a soul. A soul is the mind, will, and emotions. And your animal, your pets have a mind, do they not? Do they have a will of their own? Do they have emotions? You know, now, are they as developed as ours? No, they're not. But they have those things. But guess what they don't have? They do not have the capacity to communicate with God. Animals are what's called a bipartite creature. Man is a tripartite creature. We have this third dimension of us, which is spirit, which gives us the ability to know we have a creator, to know we have a heavenly father. Animals don't know that. Anybody's dog pray before they eat? Nobody's dog does that, you know. They don't do that. And maybe we don't either sometimes, you know. But at least we have the capacity to know that there's a God. Now, the physical world, again, we're going to have to experience this change. And change is in the future of the Christian. Here is what I understand the Bible to teach about this matter. Upon your death, your body ceases to experience life. And life is just simply the capacity to adjust to one's environment. Rocks do not adjust to their environment. Carpet will not adjust to its environment. Can animals adjust to their environment? Yeah. If it's raining, can they get inside? Yeah. I mean, they can adjust to their environment. We can too. And so that's what life is. So we have this ability to adjust. Now, when a Christian dies, their body ceases to function. It's dead. Why are they dead? Have you ever talked with a dead person at the funeral? I went to a funeral one time, and the lady who had been attending church, I didn't know her husband, he didn't come to church, and I got there, and she said, Brother Jim said, can you come down here for just a minute? And she took me down, and the casket was down there, and She introduced me to her husband. I don't know. I don't remember his name. Don, I should call him Don. I said, Donnie, this is Brother Jim. This is, I attend his church. Brother Jim, this is Donnie. I was like, how you doing? I don't know. What do you say to a dead guy? I didn't know. And anyway, she introduced me. And one day, what's going to happen to the Christian? The body is in the grave. The spirit of that individual has already been taken into the presence of the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. So at death, something is removed from the body that produces this lifeless state. And what it is the spirit of this individual. So they're empty of life. At the resurrection, the Lord is going to bring 10,000s of his saints, the Bible says. All right, this is the spirit of those bodies who are still in the grave. Jesus will then, there'll be a trumpet, and those that are in the grave will be raised. They will be rejoined with this perfect, saved spirit. They will be given a glorified body like the body that Jesus had when he rose from the grave. So what will we look like? We will know as we have been known. Know that I will recognize you. If you're Christian, you're saved, and we see each other in heaven, I will know who you are. I think, personally, that's part of the glory of heaven. You know, I know there are going to be people in heaven that I never met. I'm looking forward to meeting. There's a bunch of people that I'm looking forward to meeting. I want to meet Abraham and Moses and all those. That line's going to be pretty long, I would say. I don't know how this is going to work out. But there are people in heaven that I have never met personally. There are a lot of people in heaven that I've known personally. I grew up with them. Went to school with them. And so we've had all kinds of contact. You have too. And so I think that's part of the glory of heaven. And you know who has made all of this possible? Jesus. Did he die? Yes. Physically? Yes. Was his body actually dead? Yes. That's why they didn't break his legs on the cross. Because he's already dead. And the legs, that's how you pushed up to breathe and relax and push up to exhale. And so you could rock yourself like that and you could live for days. But they didn't want you to live for days. They had a cure for that. They had a club. They'd come along and they would bust your kneecaps wide open so you could no longer push up and then you would suffocate to death. That's how a person died on the cross. One of the most brutal forms of execution that mankind has ever designed was crucifixion. They got to Jesus. They busted the kneecaps of these guys on either side. One of them was going to be in paradise that day with Christ. But when they came to Jesus, they were like, no need to waste the swing. This man's already dead. He had already left his body. The Bible says that he dismissed his spirit. He just simply walked out of his body. All right? He was buried in a cave. 3 days later, he came out of that grave. Now, how did that happen? Well, he's God. Being God, he has the capacity to do anything. What did he look like? Well, did they recognize him as Jesus? They did. What are you going to look like? You? Perfect. That's what today is about, folks. This is not theological mythology that I'm talking to you about. This is fact. We're all going to experience this. And the person says, well, I don't believe all of that. You're still going to experience it. But now here's the difference. A person that dies lost without Christ as his Savior goes to the grave in this corrupt, dishonorable, death-ridden body. Disease-ridden, perhaps. Guess what body is going to be brought out of the ground? And guess what they're going to live in forever in what the Bible refers to as a lake of fire? Whatever body they died in. So if a person has chronic pain, chronic disease, guess what they're going to experience for eternity? Beside the torture of where they're going to be. Chronic pain, chronic disease, chronic weakness. It's just, It's going to be a horrible existence. And it's all absolutely unnecessary to die to experience that, because Christ has made it possible for us to be brought back to life in a perfectly whole, incorruptible fashion. And again, what I'm telling you, this is not philosophy. This is truth. It's what's going to happen. So if you're here this morning and you've never trusted Christ, you got a pretty bleak future ahead of you if you don't get saved. I'm just telling you ahead of time, you're going to die if you're lost and you stay that way. If you die lost, your body's going to be buried, but your body's going to be raised from the grave, and you're going to be reconnected to that. Your soul will be reconnected to the body, and that's you forever. Forever. Completely opposite for the Christian. And I'm looking forward to the day when all the pain... Anybody got any chronic pain? You hurt all the time somewhere? Got a bunch of hands going up. That's temporary. If you're a Christian, temporary. You say, well, temporary, it's been 80 years so far. Compared to eternity, that's extremely temporary. And so the scripture tells us this in verse 45. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul, mind, will, and emotions. The last Adam, that is Christ, was made a quickening spirit. So these progenitors of a brand new race, quickening means to be made alive. So Adam killed us. Jesus brought us back to life. So verse 46 says, howbeit that was not first, which was spiritual, Adam came first, that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. Jesus came into this world for this day to be raised from the grave. And he didn't do that because he needed it. He did it because we all needed it. And he has assigned this resurrection to everybody that accepts the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for your goodness. And I pray as we approach the invitation, there's somebody in this building that as of yet has never accepted the truth of the gospel, that right now, what a day to get saved on Easter. And I pray, Lord, that you would bring them to the point of confession. This church cannot save them. Their baptism cannot save them. Their good works cannot save them. Only you can do that. And I pray if there's somebody here that needs to make that decision, that they will do it before the service is over. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. As we stand, the rain plays. If you need to come this morning, we'll be glad to take a Bible and show you what you need to do to be saved. Would you come? Again, thank everybody that came this morning and all those that provided breakfast. It was really, really good. And look forward to seeing you back tonight at 6 o'clock. So y'all go home, get you some lunch and a nap, and come back tonight. All right. Let's bow for prayer. Father, we love you. Thank you so much for the meaning of this day. Bless us as we go home in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Lord.